The word is now given to Adriano Bossoni.
I'm speaking from here, it's okay?
It's fine.
Can you hear me? Oh, there you go. Does this one work?
Yeah,
it's working. Okay. So one of the goals of this forum here is to think about what Greece in particular, but the European Union in general, would look like in 10, in 20 years. But to do so, first have to consider how we got here. And to me, when I look at the situation in Europe, it's fascinating how fast the European crisis evolved from a financial crisis to an unemployment crisis to a political slash identity crisis. And if we think about the principles upon which the European Union was built, we can identify two main promises. The EU was built on the promise of peace in Europe and on the promise of economic prosperity. Thankfully, the European Union still delivers on the former, but there are big questions and concerns about the latter. And we have seen over the past few years the rising popularity of nationalist parties, anti-establishment parties, Eurosceptic parties. And an interesting phenomenon is that these parties are growing in popularity, but they are also affecting the agenda of the so-called moderate parties. We have seen moderate parties in many European countries trying to take some items from the agenda of the nationalists to be able to compete against them and not to lose votes against them. Over the past 12 months, which is a very small amount of time if you consider the number of things that have happened, we have seen three key myths of European integration being done. The first one, and you will know this very well, was the myth of the so-called irreversibility of the Eurozone. During the negotiations over Greece's third bailout, Greece got incredibly close to being kicked out of the Eurozone. There was a part of the German establishment, but not only the German establishment, and in the Netherlands, in Austria, in Finland, who seriously considered the possibility of a Eurozone without Greece. It didn't happen, but it got really close to that point. The second myth was that was debunked over the past 12 months was the myth of the German infallibility. We have seen that during the early stages of the crisis, Germany became the single most powerful and influential country in Europe. As one of the previous speakers said, a part of that explanation is because of France's relative decline, which put it in a relatively weaker position, and so the co-decision, the co-leadership of the European Union was no longer present, and the Germans found themselves, willingly or not, at the center of the decision-making process. But over the past 6-7 months, we have seen that that is no longer the case. With the refugee crisis, a plan that was created by the European Commission, but backed very strongly by the German government to redistribute asylum seekers across the EU, was simply ignored by the members. Some countries like Hungary, Slovakia, the Czech Republic, voted against it, but the rest of them didn't even have to vote against it. They simply ignored it. More recently, we have seen a multiplication of unilateral and bilateral moves. Countries along the Balkan routes have decided to cooperate with each other, regardless of whether or not technocrats in Brussels are okay with it, or regardless or not what the German government thinks of it. And the crisis is also creating domestic challenges for the ruling party and the ruling coalition in Germany, which could have significant consequences in the future because Germany is holding general elections in a year. And the third myth that was debunked over the past 12 months is the myth of the ever closer union. We have known for a very long time that there were not just a two-speed Europe, a multiple-speed Europe. We've known it for a long time, but the negotiations with the European, with the United Kingdom about its referendum forced the European leaders to openly admit not only that the UK alone would not be a part of the ever closer union, but that it was legally allowed for countries to even claim back some of the sovereignty that they gave up to separate national institutions in the past. So now we have entered a situation which is absolutely acceptable to challenge the founding principles of the European Union. And I would not be surprised if in the coming months and years the threat of a referendum becomes a new negotiation tool. Maybe not all countries are in the similar situation to make threats, but the larger the economy, the more incentive they will have to actually threaten to hold referendum on different aspects of continental integration. So now that we know how we got here, one of the things that we try to do at Stratfor is think of what will happen next. What will the European Union look like 10, 15, 20 years? So three main scenarios come to my mind. The first two are rather radical, I would say. Scenario number one involves the European Union finally evolving into a federal state, evolving into what some people have called the United States of Europe. I don't think that is going to happen. First, because of the rise in nationalism that I was describing before, but even if we didn't see a rise in nationalism, I think the process of European integration has reached a point where the next step requires such a massive amount of giving up sovereignty and compromise that most countries would never accept. Because the next step is the true creation of a fiscal union, the creation of a system of finding ways to transfer wealth from Northern Europe to Southern Europe, and in the process, Southern Europe loses whatever power it has left to apply fiscal policy. So I think that's probably not going to happen. Scenario number two is as radical as the previous one, and it involves the dissolution of the European Union. It involves Europe going back to where it was before the two world wars, with countries having some degree of cooperation, but most of the time competing with each other. I don't think that is going to happen either. Europe has simply gone too far just to let everything go to waste. So I don't think that that second radical scenario is happening either. So I'd like to think about a third scenario. It's an interesting one because we may end up having a transition from a German Europe to a British Europe. And I mean it in the sense of a European Union that nominally exists. There is something called European Union and there are institutions that operate at the European level. But it basically consists of a club of sovereign nation states that want to protect their sovereignty and want to cooperate on a limited number of issues and not involving all the countries at all times. We'll probably have a Europe that where the free movement of people is no longer a given, where there is no longer a common currency, where we see more examples of regional cooperation, Nordic countries doing their thing, Northern European countries doing their own thing, countries in Central and Eastern Europe who have very different concerns when it comes to Russia and stuff like that, doing their own thing. So I think we should start thinking about what that Europe will look like. And just to finish this part, and then I can elaborate more if there are questions, I think 2017 is going to be the most important year since the beginning of the crisis, because the two largest countries and economies in Europe, France and Germany, are holding general elections, and they are holding general elections against the background of the rise in nationalism. And we see that moderate parties are being challenged by these nationalist parties, and they will try themselves to compete them by taking some elements from their agenda.